Good afternoon, good evening, good morning. Good morning. What time today?
Apparently.
Brunch.
Good brunch.
Secondsies.
Elevensies.
Elevensies.
Second breakfast.
Second breakfast.
Third breakfast.
Second dinner.
Luncheon.
Afternoon tea.
Because this week we are doing another fan request film, which we'll get into later on. And I think it's going to be divisive to say the least. But it's a very special night for one reason above all else. And before I get into the other two gentlemen in the room with me, the dad knight is drinking tonight.
Yay. We get drunk dad knight.
Also known as Irish dad knight.
So joining me this week, obviously, the drunk dad knight himself. And also the salty, salty, salty probe Matt Richens.
So who am I salt? It's like a salt field, Salt Lake City,
you're
bitch.
You're salt plant.
Just salt.
Just fucking salt.
Just salt.
And the habitual honey vegetarian.
Hey guys.
And how are we this week, gentlemen?
Pretty good.
Not bad.
Fairly salt free.
At this point, I think you're about to have some sodium in your diet, my friend. Big time.
Open up and wait for that cum shot.
Fucking hell, man. No Legends of Tomorrow this week.
Are you okay?
No,
that was sad.
I ended on a fucking cliffhanger. I don't know. Pink eye is getting spread rampant in the 50s now.
I just don't understand this.
Maybe that's where it started.
Patient zero.
These five shows just don't know when to fucking break.
Nah.
None of them. It's like, oh yeah, we're back. The other two will go, oh yeah.
We're back.
We're off.
And back for a week. Did you enjoy that? All right, see you in three.
Psych!
See you next year. See you then. Get Netflix. Netflix, Daredevil obviously dropped. Really, you know what I like about that? Whole fucking thing. Boom, here's your Netflix. Here's your Daredevil. Watch it whatever speed you want. Here's your Daredevil. None of this fucking, here's Daredevil. And then if you wait 6 weeks, we'll give you another one. Then two in a row. Then wait a couple of weeks, give you one. Then a couple. Then
at the same time, that can be really, really bad.
Or give you like 15 minutes of one episode and then wait another 3 weeks.
It's only bad
and give
if you're dumb enough to like stay up all night the night before, say you were going to record a podcast, watch your majority of the fucking thing.
Look, you're not wrong. But
no,
it's so good. No, that's the thing. It's so good. I said, no, like, three episodes, cool. Next minute, 5 a.m.
Yeah.
Get that podium.
Don't need a podium. I have to say.
I pretty much did that with Jessica Jones once I started watching that.
I think a lot of people would like to do that with Jessica Jones 13 hours straight.
Yeah. But like, I was watching that and then I got to another episode. I'm like, I fucking need to know what.
You did the skip?
Well, no, I need to know what's happening next. And then, as I was picking the file, like, looked at the time. It was like 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, not bed.
Do you have to wait the next day?
Yeah.
There's your problem.
Yeah, that's the problem.
I was like,
that's the problem.
I didn't know what I was getting into. I just started watching this thing. It was just like, holy shit, I need to know the next episode.
Yeah.
Anyway.
That's how Netflix do it. That's how they get you.
Yeah.
That's why you got to stop in the middle of an episode. You always find the midpoint. At the 20-minute mark, there's always a proper act break where you're like, boom, I can take a break.
Yeah. I'll do that with Daredevil, I think. Otherwise, I'll be doing
The term Netflix and chill doesn't exist when you're watching shows like Jessica Jones and Daredevil, because you start watching Netflix and you just completely forget about the chill side of it.
Yeah. If you're getting it good,
she's going to bed.
She's on her knees.
Episode 16, called Falling, Supergirl inadvertently comes in contact with red kryptonite, which destroys her inhibitions. Turns out Maxwell created it in hopes of stopping Non's next attack, but instead it gradually turns Kara into a super bitch and Supergirl evil, just like her Aunt Astra. The DEO is able to subdue her, but at the price of Hank revealing himself as the Martian Manhunter.
I'm a little bit worried that Sponge's cousin has, like, broken into the Moe Studios or something. What the fuck?
Well, I change my hairstyle every segment. Get used to it.
Oh, no. Shit.
Any particular reason?
Scott Pilgrim gag.
I like to be spontaneous.
Oh. It's a Scott Pilgrim gag.
You didn't even watch the movie, did you?
Right, then, let's talk Supergirl. This is a pretty good episode.
It was a great episode.
Kryptonite. Invented by Max Lord. I actually didn't mind that because it explains why it affected her for longer than an actual kryptonite hit would.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I like that.
Yeah. I like bitchy.
Tara. Yeah, she plays a bitch well.
She's hot bitch as well.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah.
Dominatrix level of bitch, yeah. Like using the boss's elevator because it takes 90 seconds quicker. That way your boss gets her last 90 seconds.
That was good.
No, it's good. Like, I can't.
Massive amount of credit where credit's due to John Jones for doing the actual hero thing and going, no, fuck it. I've outed myself, you know who I am, I'll do the right thing.
Yeah.
I have so many crances to hand out on this show this week.
You're not wrong.
Yeah.
Alright, we'll get into it then, guys. Talk. Tell me what you like, because it sounds like all three of you loved it. Let's go. Matt joined my train of thinking. This show is great. From turning episode one, or I'd say episode one, Supergirl episode one, you were like, this show's shit. Fucking, done just bullshit. Why would I watch this shit? Why would I watch this?
This episode, I was
hope Wynn dies, and now you're like, fucking Wynn.
I love this episode.
No more for Wynn, though.
Not true, because Siobhan Smythe is a Supergirl villain.
Ooh, really?
There will be a DC directory coming soon.
I wasn't aware of that, but that makes me a little bit nice.
Just the,
You good?
Choking on a chip.
That's what happens when you eat live on air, dickhead. What are you doing, mate?
Back to probation.
Yeah,
I reckon. Read your contract.
Bust you down to sergeant.
The moment where a car threw a cat out of the window.
That was unreal.
Unfucking real. I could not believe it. And then she's just sitting there going like,
It's all good.
Yeah, she's not. She's got a couple of fours left.
Yeah.
God damn.
Bitchy Supergirl was fantastic. I'd almost watch a series, season of Bitchy Supergirl.
There was one performance, though, that I do have to call out. You guys have been very lovely to this. Not really the performance, character, I guess character progression. That's Jimmy's deal.
I don't think this was
Oh, man, this is all I want. You can totally have me now. Nah.
I'm good.
Good, I'm just going to go host rap battle. Right, Matt?
That's lip sync.
That's racist.
Well. That's a racist. You love the guy. So, nobody's got anything.
No, like, that's the thing. This episode was almost flawless, except for Jimmy. But we've got Bitchy Supergirl, Cat getting thrown around like a ragdoll. Siobhan?
Yeah, Siobhan's getting her ass handed to her.
Got her ass handed to her, as she should have.
Name drop?
Yeah, Perry White name drop.
I like to imagine is our man just sitting there when Cat grunted. He was like, her. What is a cat? Was she just here?
Not enough. I would like to see a bit more Wynn. But not just like...
That club scene
felt very mean girls, but I think that's the sort of angle they were going for with this episode.
Yeah,
it is aimed at tweeners, I think.
Yeah.
We are not the target demographic for this show. Not. They're just writing it so well that we're loving it.
Yeah,
that's
it. But it is made for teenage girls.
Yeah, absolutely. John Jones. Oh, I always get the name.
John Jones.
Fantastic.
John Jones.
Definitely. John Jones. Fantastic as always. He's possibly the most consistently brilliant character on this, and I'd almost say he's carrying the show, but with this cast pulling their weight,
is carrying the show.
Well, no, the whole cast is putting such a fantastic performance. This show actually doesn't need to be carried, unlike other shows that we've seen.
Like I said, I watched Not Another Teen Movie last week.
Yeah.
Watching her characterization, the difference between Janie Briggs in Not Another Teen Movie and Janie Briggs on Supergirl. This Janie Briggs character has evolved so much. She has evolved so much. Yeah.
Well, you could say she's put the overalls on the coat hanger.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, yeah. She's taken it. You've noticed, short hair, so no more ponytail, and no glasses. She has come full of evolution. This is why she's an ass-kicking machine.
Yeah.
That's it.
But, fucking...
I'm glad she didn't go to art school after all.
But John Jones in this, holy fuck.
Yeah, he's brilliant.
The wink that he gave Janie Briggs as well, likewise, just like, no, I got this. It's all right. And then
he's gonna be a hero.
And then when he was in the prison cell, and Janie was just like, well, Alex was just like, why didn't you leave? You could have been free. He goes, well, I can't protect you if I do that.
Mm. If he runs, like, he can't protect it.
I don't think he'll be running the. I think Janie Briggs will be running the. It's the DEA? DEA?
DEO.
DEO.
Yeah,
DOE.
He'll be running
DEO. DEO. Know your product.
Department of Extraterrestrial.
Observation, is it? Operation.
Something like that. Something starts with an O.
Yeah.
I think she'll be running the DEO these now.
Yeah.
I reckon John Jones will take more of a backseat and will be a sometimes character.
Mm.
Maybe with Maxwell Lord?
No.
Maxwell Lord's a villain.
He's a bad guy.
I liked Maxwell Lord in this episode as well. He was more of a good guy in this episode. Still can't really tell if he's bad or he's
bad
good.
He's a bad guy.
He's shown a lot more of a... Like, his motives seem to be good.
Yes. You know who else is really good about that in the comics? Lex Luthor.
Yeah, true.
Yeah.
This is Lex Luthor.
Look, you're right.
I know my product, man.
It's gonna be one of those nights.
I can.
We're gonna get enough Richard White
out. He's making appearances.
Excellent.
He's been working on some things. He just needs a bit of time to retool, I think, from what I understand.
That's fair.
He's a busy man. I mean, he's gotta polish his jag and smoke his pipe. So
that is true.
These are time consuming. They are time consuming hobbies to have.
That's true. Polishing a jag alone.
Well, I say polish his chair. He sits on
he sits on masturbation.
No, I think he just sits in a chair and watches his
his manservant.
I guess that's the best way to call them now, politically correctly.
I mean, he's from the south,
he's got
parked on his plantation.
Yeah.
So he's got someone polishing his jag while he's polishing his knob.
Yeah. There we go.
Sure.
There you go.
if that's what helps you, man. Anything else you guys want to say about this episode, or should we hand out some awards?
Yeah, just it's like I think it's like we normally find ourselves. We all agree on how fantastic an episode is, and we can't really.
All right, so start off with your Barbaras then. What do you got, Matt? Good answer.
I can't find one. I literally don't think I have a Barbara for this episode.
Bitchy behavior. I've got one.
You fenced it on.
I reckon Siobhan, for bitchy behaviour, trying to sell a story to Perry White and think that Perry White's not going to call up Cat Grant.
So well, he didn't call up Cat Grant.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. No,
She tried to sell the story. Right. She was emailing him and calling him, and then Supergirl printed it off and went to Cat, and Cat was all like, "Yeah, bitch, you think you could be better than Cat Grant? I'm Cat Grant." And she was all like, "Yeah, fair point." And she's like, "Yeah. Tired.
Can you please do a whole review like that?
It's pretty good, Cat Grant. Yeah, no, it's pretty much good. Bang on, man.
I mean, if you rang Harrison Ford right now, he'd probably ask if
I rang Harrison Ford right now, I'd be phoning in less than he phones in his performances at the moment.
That's fair.
Indiana Jones 5 is gonna suck.
Yeah.
Legit, man.
I saw that. I was like, wow, what it's the gonna fuck? Blow.
He has to die in that movie, right?
Well, he's died in everything else now, so.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Brayden, who are you giving your Barbara to?
You stole mine too. I was going Siobhan for that exact reason.
Mm-hmm.
I don't. There's no one else to pick, really, I don't think.
Yeah, she's the bitch of the episode.
Siobhan.
Right out. Barbara.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Absolutely. Jimmy Olsen. Jimmy Olsen was just like I say, this is all I've wanted for X number of episodes, like his life, X number of weeks, and now I've got it. So, obviously, I don't.
Yeah.
Want it?
Yeah.
You said some bitchy things about my ex that we both know were true, and I was kind of a dick because, like, I wanted you even though I was with her, but now I'm going to be mad because you said things that were the truth while you're affected by something that basically was a drug to you. And even though I've understood everything else that's extraterrestrial, this one time I'm going to not understand it, turn my back on you because, like, you know, I don't really have a reason.
Red light.
I need to go shave my head now.
So he Scott Pilgrimed it, basically.
It's almost like he wants it because he can't have it, and then as soon as he can have it, he doesn't want it.
Yeah, petulant child syndrome.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Crescents?
God, here we go. In order? Actually, I'm giving up. What's Brady's a max of
six.
It's a bunch. With the youngest one in curls. So, J. John Jones, Melissa Bennett for Benoit. I just want to say Bennett because Benoit has just a very tainted thing. Adam gets that reference. Janie Briggs, Cat Grant for being Cat Grant.
Cat Grant.
Maxwell Lord for continuing being creepy even though his intentions were good. And who was the last one I think it was? John Jones. Yeah, it's just,
yes, it was.
I've been drinking, John bitch. And who was the last one? I had one. I've completely brain farted it.
Win.
Win is my generic filling.
I was going to say, you always give one to win.
Yeah, I always give one to win.
Win is your heat wave.
Here's my heat wave. I can't deny that. Yeah, win.
You just want to put him on your desk like a little bobblehead, don't you?
If you get me the PopCat vinyl,
I don't think there is a win.
Not yet.
Yeah, I was on the same track as that with Brady's. John Jones, obviously. Melissa Benoit. I quite like the way she plays different characters very easily. She's very good at that. Got range. Janie Briggs.
Yeah.
Did I say John Jones? Too bad. John Jones again. And Maxwell Lord.
And finally, John Jones to give you a six.
And John Jones. John Jones.
I'm going to give out more juniors, but with an honourable mention to Cat Grant and Maxwell Lord.
So just give out Brady's. Just do it.
No. John Jones is my top one for his
everything.
Just everything.
For his everything.
For his everything. Melissa Benoit for Supergirl and Kara this week. Just fucking amazing performance. One to Janie Briggs.
Janie Briggs is on par to possibly be the female of the year.
Easily.
Yeah. Fuck yeah.
We have given her awards since this show started.
The end of that episode when Supergirl is in the...
Has a breakdown.
I legitimately felt that. I wasn't expecting that. I was like, holy fuck. I can feel like everything. I can feel the pain that she is experiencing.
Yeah.
And then to have Alex there, even though she broke her arm and beat her the fuck up, she's like... bones will heal.
Yeah.
And then everything else will just take time.
Yeah.
And she was just legit. Because she loves her sister. And then, even though she's, you did have truth in what you said, but we'll work on that. And
yeah, because she's not fucking Jimmy, that's why.
And she's not fucking Laurel. But just that last scene, I was just like, holy fuck, the whole thing with John Jones in prison, and then the Kara and Supergirl, Kara and Alex. That last scene with those three, they absolutely get my Cranstons. They get my Walt Juniors for that. Just nice. For that scene.
Yeah. I'm just giving one straight to Miss Bevel. She carried the entire episode on her back when you look at it. And playing three or four different characters.
Yeah. Because she's fairly young, isn't she?
Yes.
Yeah.
So yeah, she's 24, 25.
To jump between those sort of personality traits.
Yeah. She's about the same age as Grant Gustin because they were both on.
Back off.
What?
You're going to say they're both on Glee?
They were on Glee.
Do you want to hear? Speaking of movie pilot, do you want to hear changing the subject a bit? A headline from movie pilot this week.
Yeah, always.
Kevin Smith has directed an episode of The Flash, therefore, Jay and Silent Bob are going to be on The Flash.
I'm not sure.
Jason Mewes was present. He was in John Wesley's ship photo. Yes. But that don't mean shit.
Yeah, but that's because Jason Mewes follows Kevin Smith everywhere he goes.
Like a bitch.
Oh, gotcha. They're hetero life mates.
They're hetero life mates.
Thumbs up, thumbs down, Supergirl.
Five up.
Five
up.
Yeah.
That was fucking solid. There was not one part of that where I was just like, this episode is shit.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not one.
I'm going with four. Taking one off for Jimmy.
I'm going five. Damn good watching.
fence sitter.
I'm gonna go 5 as well, which is probably my favourite episode of this so far.
Came off the fence hard on that one.
Yeah.
And now let's move on to the next one. For fuck's sake. Alright, Terry, do you wanna... Terry, do you wanna get in this? Jesus.
Nothing, Christ. Your hair looks fantastic and shiny. Very mystique-esque.
I did it myself.
Bit of a
you really shouldn't.
Jeff Lawrence.
Episode 14 of Gotham.
Your hair's getting a bit shaggy, Braden. Maybe put on a hat.
What? No, it's not.
This ball of mud and Meanness. Shut up, Brad. Bruce receives a gun from Selena and goes on the hunt for Patrick Malone with Alfred. To get the information, Alfred is forced to fight in an underground fight club, which puts Alfred in the hospital. Good guy, Alfred. After Bruce goes on the hunt for himself, Alfred contacts Gordon and Bullock so they can save Bruce before he could be killed. Bruce locates Malone, who later seemingly confirms he is responsible for the murder of Bruce's parents. He asks Bruce to kill him, but Bruce holds back and at the last moment and yet leaves the gun behind, allowing Malone to commit suicide. Later in the cave, Alfred reads Bruce's letter about him moving to the streets to learn how to fight crime. Meanwhile, Leslie asks Gordon to investigate Kristen Kringle's sudden disappearance. When Nigma is informed, he swears to outsmart Gordon. After running a few more tests on Cobblepot, Hugo Strange declares him sane and releases him from Arkham, although states he still has plans for Cobblepot.
This was pretty decent. I mean,
it was okay.
Nothing happened, I guess. Nothing happened.
Not even the last 10 seconds, nothing happened.
No, and also, I think they reshot something, in honesty, because about the halfway point, Hugo Strange's head went from actually being his bald head to being a very fucking noticeable ball cap.
It's
a very noticeable ball cap.
It was just a weird feeling episode, like the stuff.
Yeah, like
Bruce,
I think somebody
Bruce
fucked
and
up and
Bruce...
they bridged it. But yeah. the Alfred stuff was solid,
very good.
But the thing that I found really weird, I don't know if it's because I watched so much wrestling that I know just how fight choreography is going to work. But literally, I'm sitting there and I'm next to the president and I'm like, okay, this guy's like got a foot on Alfred, so this is going to end with a sleeper hold.
Yeah. You didn't start chanting Suplex City or anything like that?
Well, I just knew. I was just like, the minute he started punching him, I'm like, okay, he's like when Bruce tries to throw in the flag and he's like, no, he's wearing himself out. I'm like, yep, and he's going to spin into that. Pretty much, I was like, being a wrestling commentator, I'm like, he is really wearing him out. I bet you he's going for the finishing move. It's the sleeper hold. The sleeper hold. I forgot him in the sleeper hold. Ah, son of a bitch, he tapped. He tapped out. Ah, god damn it.
He's got a family. Oh god.
Yeah, no, pretty much.
Yeah, it was a very off. The whole thing just felt off.
Yeah.
Out of kilt. The timing was just.
I'm pretty sure the whole point of the episode was Bruce learns that killing isn't the answer, and Edward Nigma is soon going to go full Riddler.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't understand. I could understand why he put the question mark, because, you know, what does Jim know that he's not letting on? Sure, but
I think that's him finding part of his identity, is he's going to look at that question mark now and be like, huh.
And he's like, oh, what, they think they're smarter than me, because one of the Riddler's whole thing is he thinks he's smarter than everybody, and anybody outsmarting him.
Jim doesn't give a fuck about Kristen Kringle, ultimately, the Riddler is stressing himself out, psychopathic over it.
Yeah. Just to get my head around this, Bruce is what, 13, 14? Yeah. So 10 years, basically, and he's Batman, or starts to become Batman.
10 years is the first.
I reckon 5 years would be early, early stages. You're looking at 18, maybe
if
18 to 20.
If you're talking
and
the first
Batman.
Time he goes into Gotham, like Batman Begins, for instance.
Yeah.
Right. If you're looking at the year he goes back into Gotham and puts the mask on before he even makes that news and shit, 25.
Yeah.
He is 25 the first
was
time.
Now, so he might
21. Now.
Yeah. 2021.
So he might do like a hoodie thing with, you know, in his early teens.
He'll do a Jason Todd type situation.
Yeah. But yeah, so looking at that, we've got 10 years before we get Batman, year one. So Enigma's what, 25,
30? 25. Yeah. I think they're both meant to be like... Yeah, 25. I think Penguin's meant to be maybe 19. No, honestly, I think they're meant to be a lot younger than they look.
Okay. Yeah.
Because they keep talking about how... Because Hugo Strange kept saying to Penguin, you're a delightful young man.
Hmm.
And things like that. Yeah. And that to me is normally the shit you say to somebody who's 21 and under.
Yeah.
Which makes me think that the Penguin is meant to be under 21. I think Edward Nygma is probably 23 to 25.
Yeah, finishes degree, because like when we first met him, he was only the assistant kind of, wasn't
so there? That's not too bad then, because then you're looking at maybe a 10-year gap between...
They're all a little bit older, which they're meant to be. Meant to be that little bit older than Batman is, ultimately.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. And I think that's what we're meant to be seeing here is that, like Matches Malone said, Gotham made me.
Yeah.
Gotham made Matches Malone, and Gotham is making this new breed of criminal, and that's why Bruce is saying, I need to see this shit firsthand.
Because
I can't fight what I don't understand.
Yeah.
The Bruce storyline is becoming perfect
amazing.
Now.
Amazing.
Mm.
It's just the shit around it just is so...
Discombobulated?
It's just hollow. That's what... It was a hollow episode. Yeah. You know, what... There aren't any consequences on this show anymore, because... Yeah. Jim Gordon gets a consequence within 5 weeks, he's back at his desk.
Yeah, it's a 5 week
nothing
reset.
Ever fucking Simpsons happens. Simpsons reset. Yeah, nothing ever happens. Yeah. They have this unlimited fucking police force.
And not only that, there was the whole, like, Barnes did not believe Jim at all.
No.
But there's been no follow-up.
But this week it was like nothing.
There was not even Barnes.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's just one of those...
And we got no idea what's going on with Hugo Strange. You know, they introduce these characters and then do absolutely nothing with them, or at least absolutely nothing that we even know about.
He's building an army underground for some reason, but in six episodes' time, we might give you a little bit more about that. It's like, fuck! Is this a four-episode? It feels like they want the Netflix 12-episode schedule, but somebody went, oh, here's 20, we want 24 episodes. They're like, shit. Well, they wanted six. They wanted the True Detective fucking six episodes spread. And they went, right, let's write six episodes. Boom. Here's the plot for six episodes. They want 24? Fuck. All right, filler, episode. Filler, episode. Yeah, we spread them out. Good work, guys.
Yeah. So, I mean, for someone like, considering all four of us know the Batman storyline and whatnot, for someone, some housewife somewhere, to sit down and watch this show would probably be good.
Yeah.
Because Hugo Strange is some, like, if you're writing it to, like, a housewife or, like, just a family who doesn't know Batman because they live in a cave somewhere.
Well, the Hugo Strange is the only character at the moment who makes sense because his backstory is he was the head psychiatrist at Arkham Asylum.
Yeah, absolutely.
When Bruce was meant to be about this age. Like, this is all that falling into place. The shit that doesn't make sense to me is, like, here's something they won't revisit for another fucking season, but why was that bitch have a... Why did she have a makeup like the Joker and eyes like Harley Quinn?
I was thinking about that, and she wasn't...
And pictures of fucking Jerome in the background.
Yeah.
Was it pictures of Jerome?
They were flashing. Yeah.
Oh, really? Because what I was thinking was...
All the maniacs. I think they had photos of all the maniacs, or whatever they called them.
Well, I was thinking maybe it's sort of like, you know how Alice Cooper and Marilyn Manson had the whole female first name, serial killer last name sort of thing? Could be just a front man persona sort of thing, because
but the Joker doesn't exist yet, so why?
So I know, I think it might have been just a maniac thing, and just clown.
Just weird.
It's just. I think it's just a front man.
It's just. It's one of those things where it feels like they're like, "Oh, could she be the Joker?"
I didn't get that. It more felt like she was a steampunk girl.
And it was Ledger's Joker as well.
Hmm?
It was Ledger's Joker, which doesn't exist in this universe.
I wouldn't compare it to that.
The smile, the makeup job. You said the makeup job wasn't...
Oh, yeah, the makeup job. Yeah,
like, think about it. The only person we've seen that they can base it on in this universe is Jerome going, I'm the Joker!
Yeah. Did a great Jack.
I think they're treating it as
it is.
A bit of
so her face should have been...
I think because it's like a mantle, I guess, and
yeah, but that'd be like at the moment if people are running around with like actual Batman fucking masks with the ears and everything. You'd be like, yeah.
I don't like it. Shit.
Good. I'm glad. I don't want to have to fucking come over there and punch you.
Side note, she was the tank girl.
Yeah, she was. Mm. It was Laurie Petty.
Yeah.
Bullock was...
How much did she look like Ellen DeGeneres?
Yeah, she did. It's because she's getting older and she has short hair.
Yeah. You put a short hair, grey short hair on any woman.
Are we all happy to see our man Harvey back? Yelling at Alfred not to tell the police shit, like, I'm gonna kill this guy.
We are the police, you can't tell us that!
You're supposed to tell us when you have this information!
Yeah.
He's definitely the cop's cop.
We're gonna kill him. Don't tell us that. We're the police.
He's becoming such a like clean cop, considering at the beginning he was the dirtiest of the dirty.
Yeah.
Jim Gordon really has cleaned that guy up.
I just love it. He's like, stop talking. You can't tell me that shit.
You're the police.
We're trying to help you. Shut up.
So yeah. All right. Let's hand out some awards for this one then. Who are you giving your Barbaras to? I'll go first. I'm giving mine to Edward Nygma, because, dumbass, you're bringing this shit on yourself. You were literally digging your own hole and being like, whoever put me in this fucking hole, I'm going to punch you in the fucking head.
I'm going to give it to GCPD, just because Enigma is sitting there going full retard on like how he's killed someone.
I think it's meant to be in a monologue. I think when they talk like that, it's meant to be in a monologue, like you see in the comics, but they don't want a dude just standing there going
speech bro.
Because you talk, right? You pretend to be an overlay for me. They don't want this.
Brayden, you're an idiot. You're a stupid fucking idiot, but I need you on the show.
Like,
where'd you get that wig?
Yeah. Yeah, so, who are you giving your Barbara to?
GCPD.
GCPD?
Yeah.
Who are you giving your Barbara to?
The writers. It's just, you get two characters, maybe, four characters right on the whole show. Bruce, Alfred, Jim's pretty damn good, Bullock's good, and so far Hugo and Strange is working out well. That's about it. And it's what, half the episode was decent? Nah.
Yeah, I did like the fact that as Penguin got more and more rehabilitated, his hair got less and less pointed.
Yeah.
Spread out like normal hair.
Yeah.
It's like the hair gel made him
Speaking of which, he's getting my Barbara.
Yeah.
Don't care about it. Like, all that growth that they sent him through last season is just what?
Stopped.
But I think that's part of Hugo Strange's plan.
I don't.
Yeah. No, BD Wong.
I don't like it.
I don't.
Bedwick Wong.
I don't believe that Penguin's rehabilitated. I think he's going through the motions of what he
thinks
should happen.
Well, that's what they do when you catch him and they do this sort of shit. Yeah. So if it is, it's a true portrayal.
That's literally what I think. Cause he grabbed that knife and he was just like, hang on. And there were so many points where he was talking to Hugo Strange and like he had that like, I'm going to fucking kill you moment, and then just like, hang on, I need to snap back into my character and go...
Yeah, and I think Nurse... Is it Partridge? Was that her name?
Nurse Partridge, yeah.
She saw it.
Yeah.
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 Alright. What about Cranston's?
Walt Juniors.
What?
Bruce Alfred Bullock. For self-explanatory reasons.
Straight up Alfred for mine.
Yeah.
That dude, the part where he gets a shit kicked out, and he's like, right, let's go. He fucking dies.
Pleasure doing business with yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then we take off his jacket, he's like, right, I'll just fix this up. We're like, well, I didn't get us in this situation. You didn't get us in this situation. Why? I didn't really tell me. Do what I told you. I told you not open your mouth. Now, if you open your mouth, what's happened? I'm going to have to kick this guy's ass, aren't I?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a fantastic. I love how they've made him cockney British as well.
He's just so. He's I just great. Love how cranky he is with Bruce all the time. He's like, well, you just. For like shut 5 minutes, fucking listen to me, Master Bruce.
Master Bruce.
I don't want to see you in fucking Paris, Master Bruce. I want to see you living in Gotham.
Master Bruce, don't pick up the back phone! But I love how he's still teaching him, like, how to fight while he was fighting.
Yeah.
He's just talking
him through it.
Yeah. I thought that was pretty good. Yeah. I'm going to have to give out Aaron Paul's. To Alfred and to
Master Bruce,
because that, like, you can clearly see the Batman evolving in him.
Yeah.
And you know, clear cut when he says, you're not a monster.
You're just a man.
You're just a man. And it was just like, you're fucking Batman.
And the freak out when he saw the gun, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. That's Batman as well, because Batman always does, even as a grown-up, like, as Batman... Well, he has that certain look in his face when he has to have a gun, which is that, like, I'm actually afraid of this device.
Yeah.
Mm.
And I think it is because they hit it so well. Kat says it. There's only one reason you have a gun.
Kill.
Mm.
That is it. Not a lot.
That was such a great line. There is only one reason to have a
gun. Not for protection.
Yeah, then when, like, she makes him point the gun at when that Joker bitch makes Bruce point the gun at her, and she's like, and he's like, I've been told you don't point a gun at somebody unless you plan to kill them, and I don't plan to kill you, so I'm not pointing my gun at you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was fucking awesome.
Mm. All right, you hear that, America? Take that in.
Yeah, no shit.
America.
Fuck yeah. Brad Pink giving you this
the motherfucking day.
I'm giving it Walt Juniors as well. I'm going to go with Matches Malone.
Yeah.
I liked that whole scene with him. Alfred and Bruce. Bruce is probably the main character at the moment. I'm looking forward to seeing what happens with him.
Considering that he's the goddamn Batman. It'd be a pretty shitty show if the main character of Gotham was like, man, this show's great except for Bruce.
But I didn't realize.
Well, the main character is supposed to be Jim Gordon.
No, it's not. It's fucking Gotham. Do you actually think the main character might be Gordon? The lead character is Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
The entire fucking story is who shot this little dick's parent.
Petulant bastards complaining about his parents.
Yeah, shut the fuck up and get on with your life, you whingy prick. Unbelievable. Anyway. Thumbs up, thumbs down.
I'll give it three. Three out.
Two?
Yeah, two.
One for Alfred, one for Bruce.
I'll give a half thumb each to Bullock and Gordon. So, I do like Bullock. He's good.
Alright, have we got any other Gotham thoughts before we move on to the main event?
I did like the Matches Malone and Bruce interaction. And I did like the story. Like, he was sitting there going, I've killed so many people. The young, the elderly.
Why kill babies, though?
No, but, yeah, that was good. But, like, there's more. I've killed them in many ways with knives, with fire, with guns.
You set one bloke on fire.
You set one bloke on fire, they call you Matches. Isn't the universe great? Just thought that was... But the moment where Bruce is talking to him and he's sort of gone, ah, you're the kid.
Mm.
And he's sort of like...
I still don't believe that he was the killer.
The details he gave me... Yeah, I'm not buying
it. Because it was such a... He might have, but I'm not buying it.
Because to me, I took that more... Because think about it, that chick with the smile was like, oh, Matches will be happy to see you. To me, that was more of Matches Malone wanted to die and saw that as like sweet. Also, in a very fucked up way, like he said, I'm your father. I made you.
Yeah.
So if you kill me, I make you the next me.
Didn't we have a conversation last week? This life,
you take a killer out of the world, all you've done is create another killer.
Yeah.
I'm surprised they actually let I'm not surprised he shot himself. I'm surprised Fox let them air when Jim opened the door, the gun literally falls down and falls out. I am so surprised that part, like they didn't trim that scene to just the gun. Like the gun dropping would make sense.
Like that, and then the gun.
Yeah, and then he let the fall. Yeah, just losing his handle. But the fact it went completely from the mouth down to the ground.
That was full on.
Yeah.
That's like I say, I was really shocked to see that. Really shocked.
Well, we've seen that Gotham is pretty brutal on the violent front.
But Fox.
This is an American non-cable network.
Yeah.
Like this is a show that airs at 8 p.m.
Well, by that standing, you should be surprised that they said, guns aren't for protection.
Yeah, but no, I'll put this in perspective for you. Wrestling doesn't have blood anymore, and it runs from 8 p.m. to 11 p.m.
Yep.
Gotham can have a dude with a gun dropping out of his mouth between 8 and 9 p.m.
Wow.
So that's what I'm saying. Like, really, really analyze that. And also think, this is the network that houses, like, The Simpsons and shit. That's their bread and butter. Heavy shit. It's made, like, family-ish.
Mm.
Like, in that last season, The X-Files wasn't as heavy as that. That is...
Mm.
That was as graphic as I've ever seen.
Yeah, fair call.
Like, even NYPD Blue never did shit like that.
Yeah.
Fair call.
It was always implied.
Yeah, it's very... Like, that... As I say, just I'm honestly surprised the censors let them have those three frames. I really am. I would have thought they would have cut it from... You can have it from here.
Or even just, like, from...
No, because it's in the mouth. And the fact they would have let him... the censors would have said, the minute it's out of his mouth, you can cut from there.
Yeah.
But I'm really shocked they let it actually go from... Because it was in a good light.
Yeah.
It was a second it took the sight out of his mouth. Yeah. So it was...
Very much in the barrel.
Very... If I had to explain the task of this film, or the plot of this film, I should say...
You got another?
Scott Pilgrim is a video game, I think. Brayden, why don't you tell us what this is about?
Alright, Scott Pilgrim plays in a band which aspires to success. He dates Knives Chow, a high school girl 5 years younger, and he hasn't recovered from being dumped by his former girlfriend. Now a success with her own band. When Scott falls for Ramona Flowers, he has trouble... A girl with hair like this. He has trouble... Well, with he has trouble breaking up with Knives and tries to romance Ramona. As if juggling two women wasn't enough, Ramona comes with baggage. 7 ex-lovers, with each of whom Scott must do battle to the death in order to win Ramona. Now that is the plot. That is basically the plot.
All right.
There's not much of a...
I have a theory on this film, and I've told this to Terry earlier, but I'm going to put it out there now on the record. This is my theory for this film. Okay? Edgar Wright loves to make films with Simon Pegg. I think originally this was written for Simon Pegg, and Simon Pegg was in a car crash or some shit happened, and he couldn't make it to set. Michael Cera was there visiting somebody on set, probably Alison Pill, I don't know, maybe Brie Larson, I don't know. He's visiting somebody, and Edgar Wright was like, fuck, I need to, you'll do, stand in there and say the words, and we'll just like CGI Pegg over the top afterwards. But then the graphic artist's thumbs fell off. So they couldn't CGI Peg in over the top, so they got left with Michael Cera. Because that dude...
See, visually...
Can't act.
Oh, yeah.
Visually, I actually really like Michael Cera in this movie. I think he looks fucking hilarious in those fight scenes.
Yeah, I think that's the point.
And I think he looks fucking hilarious with a guitar.
Dancing and playing bass was the most... Okay. This is the inverted Napoleon Dynamite, right? In that they're both fucking weird, and they have no point to them.
Yeah.
But if I have to watch more than 15 minutes of Napoleon Dynamite, I will literally perform a vasectomy on myself and beat myself to death with my now castrated bollocks. Right? Whereas okay, well, this film, I can actually make it through. It's like, I don't understand what the fuck is happening, but this is just weird.
It is fucking weird. It is completely ridiculous. It is so...
He grinds down a ramp to 270 kilometers an hour and then fucking explodes in a bombshell. And everybody explodes into coins.
Kick him in the balls!
The gay roommate. The whole fuck... Okay, and okay, just putting this out there. Right, there's certain times you watch a movie and you're sitting there and you're like... You start relating to certain characters or certain people from your life. I'll be fucked if the drummer in Scott Pilgrim's band is not just somebody who just didn't follow the president around with a fucking tape recorder. Wait, just jot shit down, then went, yep, bang, just play this. I'll be goddamned if that's not the case.
You're definitely not wrong. You're not wrong.
Literally, it was like, look, I'm just like, I don't. Why am I watching this movie? I'll just talk to her. She's right there.
Yeah. I loved her. She was great. She just hating on Scott the whole fucking time.
It's because he broke her heart and he couldn't even remember why.
Dude, he's a dick. He just forgot.
I think
it's funny as well because he's got this reputation of like getting all these girls and fucking just ripping them to shreds emotionally. And he's just a fucking ugly little skinny little shit. It's fucking hilarious.
The girls in this film, like let's
be honest.
Okay, let's I need to put this politically correctly. So the editor doesn't kick my balls. All of the fathers and mothers, the ladies involved in this film, should be very proud they've raised some very charming and lovely looking lasses.
Davey Hot Bitches? It's your balls that are on the table.
That's
why
you
there,
can
so...
say whatever you like, yeah. But yes.
Davey Hot. It's a fine selection of femmes. So, yeah.
Apart from Michael Cera, the cast all look good.
Yeah, it's a good
the
looking
The dude
cast.
Who is the singer in his band is the weirdest looking motherfucker.
Mark Webber.
That's a weird looking dude.
It's very weird.
The girls are hot. If you honestly get too many girls aren't hot.
No, I'm not saying that at all.
Edgar Wright can love the cast, man. He makes me want to see a movie.
In this movie. They're all fucking...
Brandon Roth. You're going to call Brandon Roth? You're going to call Evans?
Christopher
Evans.
Captain Mark.
Come on, you're talking about...
Johnny Flame.
You're talking about Pink Eye and...
And Johnny Flame. It's about as bad as you got to get with that Chris Evans.
True.
I mean, even the chin strap, he's the only man I've ever seen pull off a chin strap. I was like, god damn, he's pulled this shit off.
Oh. Yeah.
And he has a stunt double team that all talk exactly like him.
I'm going to coffee, you want one?
No, I'm good, thanks, man.
Good. So, why do you hate this movie, Matt? You're sitting over there sighing, sulking like...
Hang on. Hang on. Before we do anything else, I've got a new feature here from the cave that I need to show off. Brayden, in feature with your favourite film, you and Matt are going to go one-on-one once again, just like last week with The Rocketeer. This time the roles are reversed. However, this time we're taking up a step because we're going to Red Alert. Now, we're on Red Alert, so that means Brayden. Matter of fact, Terry, kill the lights. Alright, we're on Red Alert.
Except for Mo.
Mo's still on white because, well, let's just face it. The fact he can get lights in Mo.
I can see the lights.
There you go. Alright, we're on Red Alert. You don't have to see me or Terry. We're not important right now.
In fact...
Alright.
We are just ships passing in the night.
Matt, Brayden. Matt. Yeah, Matt, Brayden. That's your name. Fuck. Red Alert has begun. Let the Scott Pilgrim round one argument. Fight!
Alright, Scott Pilgrim versus the universe, or the world, whatever the fuck this movie is called, should be called Sponge Pilgrim Faces the World.
Fuck, Jesus. What?
Yep.
Continue.
Because the dude's a fucking retard. Like, I'm sitting there watching this fucking numpty going around. Oh, I don't know if I like this girl. I don't know if I love her, but I love her. I don't know if I love her. I think I love her. I don't know. But
I'm going Shaggy.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm going to play in a band and I'm going to be a rock star, but I don't know that I can play that well, and I don't know that I can fight your seven exes, and I don't know what's going on in the world, so I'm just going to, like, talk and judge everything that I do more over than once, and yeah, I think I'll just play bass.
Wow, that was horrid. That is not this movie, not at all. Yeah, he's like weirdly emotionally scarred by this other girlfriend, but they do it in a comedic way where it's just fucking retarded. When you say he's played by like a fucking retard, you're damn fucking right, and it's entertaining. Every word that comes out of that dude's mouth and all the conversations and everything that go along with it are just hilarious.
Like you shat on The Rocketeer where you didn't find it hilarious at all. I literally watched this movie like this. I was like,
The Rocketeer wasn't meant to be a comedy. This was.
Well, if this was supposed to be comedy movie, it was literally like a fucking...
Use your words, man. Shut up.
You in the dark. You're not fucking heard. This is just like...
There was nothing
about this movie that made me laugh. I was literally watching this fucking going... The fuck am I watching this piece of shit for?
Matt. I'm legitimately sad for you. I feel pity on you.
How are you literally sitting there going, this wasn't funny, when we had Brandon Roth sitting there as a super-powered vegan?
He was Big Daddy Brian.
Your mate, the Punisher, bursts through a wall and cites off three times he broke vegan policy. Went half and half, imbibed chicken. Chicken isn't vegan? No! And then took his... And then Brendan Roth crosses his eyes with one straight and the other one looking up and to the right. How is that not funny?
Could not find any part of this movie funny at all.
Really?
No.
I suppose you look at Monty Python and went, well, that's a tragic drama.
No.
What the ever-loving fuck, man?
No.
Ow!
I just fucking hate it. Like, I literally cannot enjoy watching that movie. And I'm pretty sure that the first time I watched this movie, it was just like, fucking, bang, you are gone from my hard drive. Fuck off.
What was it doing on your hard drive?
Well, I have a child...
So you bought the DVD and ripped it to your hard drive, is that what you're saying?
Listen, I have a child with autism who likes spinning things. Yeah. You spin a DVD on a surface, you scratch the fuck out of it...
So that's what I'm saying, you own the DVD and you rip it to your hard drive.
I bought all my DVDs and I'll rip onto the hard drive.
I just wanted to cover that base, that's all, you know, for sensors.
Yeah. So that I have a backup and then the DVDs go into storage so that they don't get scratched.
So it's a good thing you've still got the DVD somewhere in your house.
No, I snapped it. Like Daredevil.
Oh. Well, I own this on Blu-ray and I don't regret it.
That's a wise investment.
Outside of the comedic value of this
movie, like Jennifer Lawrence's
vagina. I love all the I guess, pop culture references, the music, like the Zelda music and the video game references, things like that are a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Even just the music that the different bands play and stuff like that, so Sex Bomb Bomb and the Clash of the Demon Head, I love their song that they actually play on stage. I actually really enjoy the music in this movie. It's really good.
The unfortunate thing about it is with the pop culture icons, it's going to largely appeal to 20-plus something, so as this movie ages, it's not really going to transcend too well to younger audience. I mean, that's why you and I will probably find it, because we have taste, unlike some other long-haired cretins who look like, you know, lead singers of Canadian rock bands.
I don't look like Joe Sisko from Still Love. Wait, that's Love Our Canadian. Damn, my joke failed!
I don't know, somewhere in the dark.
Alright, we're going to yellow alert. Assuming my... There we go. Now, obviously, we're still at heightened tensions here. It's like Israel.
Palestine.
Exactly. This movie is really weird.
It's stupid. It's not weird, it's stupid.
Here's what confuses me the most. I know it's a film, and films take place in the reality where Seth Rogen apparently just can make a cheeky one. But I counted all up at different points. There are five different chicks. Four different chicks. So you have the hots for Scott at once, because you got the drummer who still has a thing until he apologizes at the end.
Ellen Wong.
You've got Knives. You've got Mary Elizabeth Winstead as
Ramona.
And then you've got...
you've got...
Brie Larson's character.
Envy, that's right, yeah.
So you got four of them at once. Okay, here's my question. In two parts.
Okay.
Badger the Thunder, if you like.
Badger the Thunder.
Okay, ready?
Yeah.
In what fucking reality are four hot chicks chasing Michael Cera at the same time, let alone
that's
ever?
That's why it's so funny. That's what's so good about it.
And secondly, right?
I think Wallace has got a song for him.
Why
as well.
Is he having such a fucking meltdown? Oh, okay. The better way of me phrase my question. Okay? This is literally all I thought watching this film. Okay, this dude clearly is a narcissistic sociopath with schizophrenia, and this is how he sees the world. Mm-hmm. I'm watching a schizophrenic's view of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Is that what this is? Is that what this is meant to be? Am I correct? Have I hit the subtext? He's meant to be a fucking schizo.
Possibly, yeah, 110%. Yeah.
Like, it fits so much. I actually think it's meant to be from the point of view of a schizophrenic.
It would not surprise me at all.
Because think about it. Ready for what I actually think that what? Okay. No. It's time to go film school dropout with Red Thunder, and here it is. Right?
Go back to film school.
Ready?
Go get his coffee.
Ready? Hear what it is. Get my half Dr. Pepper, half Cherry Coke. Know your product. here we go. You ready?
Yeah.
Scott Pilgrim was dating a 17-year-old girl in Rebound from the original girlfriend. What I actually think the real story there... I'm talking real world. So take away the schizophrenic dream, we're talking the real world.
Mm-hmm.
Envy's band...
Yeah.
...probably did get, like, signed to some shitty... they're playing some shit gig... Or a shitty independent label, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's upset him, so he's envious of that. That's where he, in her mind, she becomes envy. So to rebound from that, he started dating this 17-year-old girl because he wants some control and power in his life, but it's not really working because he meets Ramona and then he's just like, well, shit. Mm. She's the girl of my dreams. Literally.
Yeah.
Literally.
Right? But she's telling him. Now, what happens when you go on a date with a girl? Because I think that first date where they walk through the snow and all that, there's some reality to that. That's happening in the real world. But what do you talk about in your first... What do you normally talk about in the first few dates?
Past
relationships,
yeah.
Okay, so what she's probably going, oh yeah, I've got an ex-boyfriend. One of them was like, the guy dated in year 9 was a movie star and all that. Now, if he's a paranoid schizophrenic, his entire life view then is from like, well, shit, all these guys are better than me. I need to be better.
Yeah,
so in his mind, he needs to fight them and better them.
Yep.
Even if it's on just a subconscious level. Mm-hmm. So this whole film is his subconscious processing what she's telling him about her past relationships.
Oh, yeah. 110%.
And the battles are him trying to overcome that. That's why at the end when he's like, you know what, I want to be with you.
Mm.
That's what the growth is that this schizophrenic and this dude, this sociopathic narcissist actually sees the world as, like he gets his self-respect, he gets his self-confidence, he gets all this shit that makes him stop being a tool.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think you're looking into it maybe a little bit too much, but you're not far off.
Yeah, I think he's pretty much bang on. He's pretty much bang on, because like at the end he does draw out the sword of self-respect, +7 and all that.
Because think about it, he wrote the level twice because he fails it in his own mind.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because it was all about her, not about him.
Yep.
And then when he makes it about him, he actually learns the more important lesson is that, yeah, when it's about him, he gets strength from himself.
Yeah, his final battle is more about himself as well.
Yeah, his final battle is against himself, and then he ends up talking about
it. He's right, we're going to go do brunch
Which
tomorrow.
Is such an Edgar Wright ending.
Yeah.
But it's more of the fact of, like, he ultimately overcomes his narcissism to want to be with her because she makes him a better person.
Absolutely. I think you've been...
By being with that, and even that thing at the end, he's confronted by his ghost of his past because he's become a better person by the end.
Absolutely.
And he parts ways with it amicably, because the whole thing, he's been scared to ever grow up and do anything. He parts way amicably with his past to move into the future through that door with the girl of his dreams.
Yep.
Film school. Boom. Did I actually just dissect that entire film and unpack it properly?
Yeah, pretty much.
All right, see you. It's been fun.
Yeah, pretty much.
Is that all we've ever needed to do to get rid of it?
Wait a minute. I'm cancelling it. The alerts are over. I've won.
We've made peace in the Middle East.
Have I settled it for you now, Matt? Why you can watch it? Because it is just helping you understand schizophrenics.
Little bit. This movie, probably the most fun thing I've ever watched. Most
it's very fun.
Fun.
Visually, it's very good.
Okay.
Yes.
You know what? I'm going to... throw mine out now and I'll come back to it in a few minutes as to why. My Cranston Award winner is Edgar Wright, because this is legitimately the most beautiful film I've ever seen.
Yep.
From a visual standpoint. I sat there throughout this entire film, I'm like, I've never seen anything. Well, I've seen... Zombieland is the closest thing I've seen to being like this. And after seeing this, I was like, man, Zombieland really wanted Michael Cera as the lead and just wanted to try to copy the Scott Pilgrim formula, didn't it?
Pretty much.
Because here's the thing, you ready?
Mm.
Michael Cera? Poor man Jesse Eisenberg.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Oh! Oh!
Ow! He is! 110%.
Am I wrong?
No, he's shit. Oh.
Am I wrong, Frank?
I'm not a huge fan of him. I liked him in this film visually. I
suppose you liked Juno as well.
Juno wasn't actually horrible.
Okay, so I'll rephrase it. You probably liked Michael Cera in Juno as well.
I'd
have to rewatch
it to be able to comment.
Sorry, you'd have to watch it.
I saw Year One in the cinema when I was in. The movie Year One with Jack Black and Michael Cera. I was in a cinema in like Wollongong or somewhere. I was in the middle of fucking buttfuck New South Wales, like proper rape country. There were banjos and buck teeth everywhere.
Yeah.
Jesus. I went to see that movie. Okay. Literally, this is... hear me out. This is how bad this film was. I saw this film. It's an hour and a half long. Walked out of it with my then-girlfriend at the time. Walked straight to the ticket counter and went, I need tickets for Transformers 2. I need to wash the taste of that out of my mouth. Because if I go home having seen that, I'll shoot myself.
I'll do you one better. I got that with... I bought it on DVD and then put it on the hard drive. I hadn't watched it at this point. I didn't see it at the cinema.
Very, very legally responsible of you, Matt.
I know. Thank you. Anyway, I'm watching it with Emily.
Piracy is a crime. You wouldn't download a car.
No,
I fucking would. Mate.
I would actually.
If I could download a fucking car.
Batmobile.
3D printer.
No, fucking stop me, man. I would need a new. I'd be printing a new level to my fucking house first.
Just garages.
Bottom level to put the fucking cars in.
Anyway. Emily and I are watching Year One. I think we got 3 minutes in. Or like, fuck it. Let's watch something else.
Yeah.
Okay. Through Year One was the fact that Junior Temple was cute, the only cute girl in the entire film. And every time she'd show up, I'd be like, oh, thank God, there's something worth putting my eyes on in this fucking movie.
Yeah.
I cannot.
Fuck me.
I love Jack Black.
That movie made me hate him. I stopped.
Same.
Because Gulliver's Travels came out next, and I was like, nope, you're done. Your career is done, son. Thanks very much. Just be Mike Myers, make your animated film, and just go away and get fat.
Yeah. Go back to School of Rock.
Yeah.
I don't think he's allowed within... After the events of School of Rock 1, he's not allowed within a certain number of feet of a school anymore. So.
That's true.
School of Rock 2 will be, Dewey, you going to prison.
I can't stand Michael Cera at all. Anytime he's on the TV, or fucking wherever I'm watching it, I'm just like...
Alright, well, I think that's as good a time as any. Let's get into it. Let's hand out Barbara's for this film.
Michael Cera.
Sorry, no, I'm going with the first Evil X. I can't remember his name, but I hated the stupid little dance he did with his demon ghost.
He was the Bollywood guy.
The Bollywood dude.
He was gold.
I liked him until he did that song. I didn't like that song.
It's
that song pissed me off.
You like talking about pop culture like, and you go, I don't like Bollywood.
Like the pop.
I love all he's the like, pop culture, but I hate pop culture.
I just want to see his costume. He's dressed like a pirate. Yeah, you dressed like a pirate? Pirates are in right now!
Yeah!
I just want to point something out here, Brayden. You're not liking Bollywood is sounding a little bit mad, and by that I mean racist.
I didn't like his dance. That's
I love all the pop culture references in this movie, but I fucking hate all the pop culture references.
Man.
Oh, God.
Matt's, I didn't like his
Matt's
dance.
Salt level of what he wishes his KFC chips levels were at.
Yeah. So you don't like Bollywood X? What was his name?
Yeah.
Kamau?
Benny Lover.
I forgot.
What?
One sent the email.
Have you seen the Benny Lover
Didn't
song?
You read my email?
Yeah.
I'm over it. I love it. He's like, this is so boring.
When he orders the package and just sits in front of the front door waiting. Okay, here's a true story.
You've done that?
No, I've not done that, but like, the president wasn't in the room when that happened, which made me really happy because I know she would just been like, ha! Fucking you, mate. No, and I would have been upset because I'd have been like, God damn, don't compare me to Michael Cera in any context.
Well, you have facial
Go
hair.
Back to your drum kit.
Where he looks like a pedo, you actually look like a bearded pirate.
I mean, his hair's getting a bit shaggy. Pirates are in this year!
I didn't say a word!
Highlander.
Well, it's a good thing I am the Highlander because they can be only one.
I'm glad you got the reference.
But, who are you giving your Cranston to? As I said, I'll kick it off so you guys give time to think. I'm giving it to Edgar Wright because literally this film, I've never seen a film that looks like this.
Yeah.
I've not seen another film that looks like this.
I'm going to give out Aaron Paul's because I love the Evil X is what drove this story. So, for me, it's Chris Evans taking the piss out of practically himself as an action hero skateboarder doing a grand thingy on the rail and then blow up in the corner.
Of course I have stunt doubles.
Yeah. And then Brendan Routh.
I'd be nothing without my team.
Brendan Routh as the vegan who ended up being vegan. That was a bad joke by Sarah. It was horrible.
It was so shit. I love it.
You're such a dad.
Vegan.
Gone. And definitely honorable mention to the director. Who was it?
Edgar Wright.
Yeah, because
the man responsible for, or who was originally going to be responsible for Ant-Man, but is responsible for Hot Fuzz, Shaun of the Dead, and Edward's End.
That's okay. Edward's End. Oh no, that's the one in the tavern. Sorry. Yeah. This is the end. Sorry.
No, this is the end. Seth Rogen.
Yeah, that's the end. But no, I mean honorable mention because that it is fantastically shot. The visually, it is absolutely stunning. Even to the point where we had oh good lord, what's his name? Stacey Pilgrim, and is it Anna Kendrick? No.
Yeah.
Anna Kendrick as a sister and her mate who was...
I didn't realise how small that chick was until I saw her walking.
Yeah, who's the mate who's always putting she always had the bars on her mouth?
Julie.
Yeah, Julie Powers, Aubrey Plaza.
Yeah, Aubrey Plaza.
That was fantastic. Yeah, that was fantastic.
How are you doing that to your mouth?
Yeah. It's one of those things where it's absolutely phenomenal.
It's the little things like that. That's what I mean. It's the things the director and the writer have done, like putting little things like that, where you're like, that's really clever. But the film itself, you're just like, this is Superman 3.
Yeah, like, Superman
3 is funny. I'm talking like the Richard Pryor shit where you're like, it feels like it doesn't belong in the film where you're like, why is he wearing this cowboy hat and drinking with this dude?
Yeah.
That is Scott Pilgrim versus the world.
Yeah.
But Scott Pilgrim intentionally does it. Superman 3 was just shit.
I think Superman 3 intentionally put Richard Pryor in to be funny. And he nailed it.
Mm.
I'm not nagging. I'm the one who liked Superman 3!
Yeah,
to quote Matt, you fuck.
Hey, allegedly.
Allegedly. No, you.
Allegedly.
That's you.
That's pretty much. I'm pretty sure
you're giving out Brady.
His head is right there.
You fuck.
The evidence is right there.
You fuck.
Oh, God.
I'm giving out Brady for this.
Yep.
Oh, for fuck's
sake. I'm going visually, Michael Cera, because I loved him in his fight scenes. I think he looked fucking good for a skinny little clunge. Edgar Wright.
I've never heard him say it before.
This movie was probably the most fun movie I've ever watched, I think. So I'm going Edgar Wright. Wallace was probably my favourite character
fucking
in this
Wallace,
movie.
Fucking Wallace, I keep forgetting. God, Wallace. Kick him in the balls! Scott, I'm going to be my own best.
Is that
tonight.
Girl on the drums a guy too?
And for the rest, yes. And for the rest of the year.
And for the rest
you
of
see life. Where this is going?
Whoever did the music, everybody who was involved in the music, I loved the music.
Mm-hmm. Music is fun.
And also, Brandon Routh and Chris Evans, they were a lot of fun as evil exes.
Mm-hmm.
You're trying to convince me to do a thing.
Can you do a thingy down the thing?
Can you give me a new grind down that ridiculous in the last staircase?
The rail's absolute garbage. Oh, you're
you
not
don't think you can
cool
do
enough?
It.
You don't think there are girls
you're
here.
Not going to get me to do it. There are girls watching. Get my board.
I love it!
I
love it!
I think I actually lost, vocally laughed out loud.
Have you got a Cranston?
What a cock.
Are you? Fuck you! Fuck you!
Take on red!
Fuck!
No, I've lost control! Shit! It's round two! It's round two! Go!
Go! Fight!
What? Piece of shit.
This movie?
Nah,
fucking you're right!
Just fuck you.
Yeah, fuck you. Shit movie.
How could have you not had a good time watching this movie? I had a fucking good time.
Last time
Matt
had a good time was in 1932.
And it cost him $50. That's the simplest show.
Watch it. Watch it. Watch it, you. I have no gripe with you, sir.
Who? I'm just a shadow in the dark.
No, fucking terrible movie. And you know what? I'm going straight off the bat. 5 thumbs down.
Holy shit, Brayden, here we go. No, leave the lights off, Brayden. Brayden, I want a response. I want your most angry, vitriolic response.
Yeah, riveting. Just like that fucking piece
that
of shit
you.
Movie that came out.
I'm comparing you to Jennifer Lawrence.
Wow.
Right.
Yeah.
Come from the person that has the wig like Jennifer Lawrence.
Looks nothing like Jennifer Lawrence.
No, you fucking other one.
Do you want to know something funny? I laughed really hard today. I was doing I'm skipping a little bit ahead, but I was doing some research for our Badger the Badger question, and I was Googling popular female actresses.
Mm-hmm.
First one that came up, Jennifer Lawrence. I was like, ha! Piece of shit.
All right. Thumbs up, thumbs down.
5 up.
I'm gonna go 3 because I still don't understand it.
You're just confused.
5 up.
I really was.
Is it kind of like the lipstick vandal thing that I showed you with Samuel Jackson and
Channing Tatum?
Yeah, you had a really weird boner.
Yeah, it was more of a case of like this film. Like I got confused by the fact that I'm sitting there and I'm like, I don't know what, like, you know when you get, you know, art house films having films like. A movie and somebody goes to see an art house film in a movie, it's always something French.
Like
and it's
some
like,
man smoking
it's,
in a corner.
It's like the one
monkey.
Where, you know, it's like the Barney film from fucking The Simpsons, right? That's what I felt like watching this, but I couldn't look away. I'm like, I can't stop watching this, and I don't know why I'm watching it in the first place. I'm so fucking confused.
So much fun.
It's great fun.
It is good fun. I'm not arguing that away from it. It's just confusing.
It's like it's a popcorn film. It's literally you sit there, drink, and eat popcorn, and that's it.
All right, let's wrap it up. Let's go to Badger the Badger.
Badger the Badger question, ladies and gentlemen. We had zero responses because apparently it fried all our fans' brains. It really wasn't that hard a question. The question was this: we had to recast Legends of Tomorrow's top 7. So basically, recast. Rip Hunter, Heatwave, Captain Cold, or Citizen Cold, as I'm calling him now. The Atom, Sarah Lance, and I do apologize, I've forgotten one of the characters.
Stein,
of course, and Firestorm. Yeah, yes. Firestorm. So, give me what you got, Douche Knight.
Well, I bent the rules big time because I didn't read it until later when I'd half done my list and like, actors between 1930 and 1960,
mm-hmm.
I fucking barely know any, let alone know any that could pull these roles off. So. What's that?
That's what IMDb's for.
IMDb.
IMDb.
That's product.
I wanted to make informed decisions, so I wasn't going to rely solely on IMDb, and I didn't really have time to watch movies from 1930 to
1960. All right. Excuses, Malone.
I've just gone with actors, whoever.
Okay.
So my list consists of Rip Hunter. I would like to see a young Bob Odenkirk.
Oh, fuck's sake. Better call Saul. Boy.
Yeah.
Okay.
The Atom. I thought maybe Brendan Fraser was probably similar to...
Good Lord.
Yeah.
To that.
If anything, put him in Stein, please.
Heatwave, I really struggled with... to try and find someone to pull that sort of, I guess, personality off. This person I picked is from the Arrowverse already, so
mm-hmm.
wouldn't really work, but I went Manu Bennett.
You're not wrong. It'd work.
Captain Cold, I actually went with Milo Ventimiglia, who played the ogre last season in Gotham.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yep.
Yeah.
Martin Stein, I struggled with. I love that man, and anyone to fill those shoes, I thought they had to have pretty big feet, so I went fucking Bryan Cranston, motherfucker.
Oh, fucking Jesus. All right.
Jax Jefferson, I couldn't find anyone. Yeah. But to be completely honest, LL I don't think it would take very much.
LL Cool J.
Oh, doesn't he already play him?
Yeah, so but he plays everybody, so you just there's only one black man that's LL Cool J.
Hmm.
Oh well, LL Cool J then. And Sarah Lance, my train of thought was who can kick ass and who would I enjoy watching make out with other females?
The Rock.
So I went Scarlett Johansson.
Ooh, not a bad answer.
Pretty good answers, but completely invalid the question, so no points for you. Love you. Matt, you didn't do your homework, did you?
I didn't. To be honest, I've had three fucking shit weeks. That's all right. So.
That's okay. That's fair. That's arm.
You ready? Ready for the correct answers for the correct time periods.
Well, how about we go... character for character. Since right. we did our homework,
all right,
I had no choice.
Top of the top, did you go all out? I threw the bonus in and gave Vandal Savage as well.
I do have an answer for.
But I thought I'd go. I thought I'd do the extra bonus question and go full Hermione on this one.
Leviosa.
Ready?
Yeah.
It's Leviosa. number one, Rip Hunter.
Yes.
Errol Flynn. Errol Flynn.
Nice. He was Australian actor, wasn't he?
Australian actor with a notoriously giant penis who's just like, are you a female? You want a root? And they'd be like, yep.
They'd be the pause as well, like, yes. Yes, I do.
Or as Ricky Gervais likes to say, would you like a portion?
Would you like a portion? All right, Rip Hunter. Well, I've gone one of two actors I'd like to see. Yep. Sydney Poitier. From Look Who's Coming to Dinner and... Oh, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner?
To Sir With Love.
And To Sir With Love.
I nearly actually cast a young Sydney Poitier as my Jefferson Jacks.
It'd be very good.
I have a better answer, though.
Jefferson Jackson. Either way.
John Johns.
Or,
it's all LL Cool J. Just a young LL Cool J.
Well, I went for Sydney Poitier or I'd like to see Steve McQueen.
Oh, Steve McQueen, interesting.
Okay. I like him. He's a nice, strong character.
Okay, my next one was The Atom.
Yes.
Ready?
Mm-hmm.
James Stewart.
Oh, yes.
Nice.
Yes.
In fact, not the... Yep.
Yep.
I said, I'm going to win this list, motherfuckers. I'm going to win a prize from my own wall.
Legit, I was just looking on at IMDb for 1930s characters. And I just saw James Stewart.
Well, there you go. You can take some screenshots as we reel off, so maybe we can bribe the editor to throw up some images on the.
I'm sure they'll be there.
All right, so for the Atom, I went for a young Jack Lemmon.
Mm-hmm.
Very crisp-looking man back in the day.
Not bad.
Unfortunately, I couldn't find a role for his mate Walter Matthau. Which I wish I could.
Alright, no. Who'd you get for Heatwave?
Heatwave. Where are you on my list? Ah, I went for one, Rock Hudson.
Rock Hudson, not a bad
Rock
answer.
Rock Hudson, just for the name, Rock Hudson.
You ready?
Yeah.
Kirk Douglas.
I am Heatwave.
Would you fuck with Kirk Douglas?
No.
No.
Well, no one fucks with Kirk Douglas.
I'd be fucked by Kirk Douglas, but I wouldn't fuck with him.
Sadly, a lot of people were against there. Well, but let's move on. Putting original Cosby to Kirk Douglas. Who did you give for your Citizen Cole then?
Citizen Cole, I went for James Dean, young, the Rebel
James
Without a Cause.
James Dean, interesting. I went for Cary Grant.
Cary Grant.
Salt and pepper in there already.
Oh, nice.
Just like the current Captain Cold.
That's nice. I like that.
Pull off the colds there.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right, let's talk.
Sorry, I just stumbled across the name. I reckon it would be an awesome Rip Hunter.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Clark Gable,
not bad.
He really wouldn't not give bad. A
damn. All right. Because Matt is pretty much a clunge biscuit and jumps in on segments he doesn't actually have, he actually broke my next one, which was Dr. Stein was Clark Gable.
So
it'd be really great if he can make up his mind and either have a list or not have a list, that'd be great, but not actually do it live on the show when he's been listening to his co-host.
That is
probably
true.
A better way to go about
it. We need
it.
Some Vivaldi in the background for this as well. Every time we're having a conversation.
I wish we could turn his, just isolate his light the fuck off. Anyway.
So you went for...
But my electrician didn't put in individual switches.
Jefferson Jackson,
my answer. This is my one sheet.
African American or what?
I went African American, okay. And this was my one sheet.
I'm thinking Danny Glover for some reason.
It was a young Morgan Freeman.
Nice.
I'm thinking if you got Morgan Freeman in about the 50s mm-hmm. or 60s, mm-hmm. back when he was a Black Panther.
He was one, yeah. Absolutely.
So that's my answer, Morgan Freeman.
I went with Sammy Davis Jr. from the Rat Pack.
They're very fitting for the era.
Absolutely.
Who'd you get for your Sarah... Lance.
Sarah Lance. I went for a bit of a face on this one. Mm-hmm. Julie Andrews.
Pretty good answer. I went for Anne Margaret.
Ooh. Anne Margaret. Nice.
And finally, Vandal Savage.
I went with someone I think could probably pull it off. I went with Dennis Hopper.
Dennis Hopper's not a bad answer. He's pretty good in speed. Mm-hmm. Would you like the correct one? The correct evil bastard Vandal Savage.
Yeah, go on.
I went... Jack Nicholson.
Nice.
Paint the beard on Jack Nicholson with the widow's peak from The Shining.
110% correct, yeah, absolutely.
Another name that would...
All right, Matt, give us your post-production list now that you've done your homework.
I haven't
Live
done
on
more.
The show.
No, just...
I'm listening, I'm just...
Reel them off.
Fuck you, then.
What have you got?
I was thinking Humphrey Bogart.
For
Savage.
Ooh. Not bad.
Fitting. But Little Man Syndrome.
Bogey would also make a pretty good Stein, too.
Mm-hmm. He would.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Wasn't too busy fucking.
Alright, is there a badger for this week?
There is. Alright, so, I've been playing a lot of PS4 lately. And I was thinking, with the last video game you played, legitimately played, you've spent some hours, what DC character could you take... and fit into comfortably into that world, like I've been playing Far Cry Primal.
I was going to say, you now, don't have the answer I would already imagine most people have for that.
Banned superheroes.
Green Arrow.
Batman is banned. Superman is banned. Wonder Woman is banned.
What's the point of playing a fucking game? Batman's banned. Fine.
Batman is banned.
Fine. Can this be from him? So this, what comic book realm was it from?
No, DC or Marvel. It's up to you. But obviously the big names, like you can't go, oh, I want to put Superman in Far Cry Primal. You can't do that because it's stupid. Aesthetically, it just doesn't fit. Like, you could put Ollie from the Island in Far Cry Primal. It would work a little bit. You could actually just take Ollie and put him in the Island.
Couldn't you
Far
put
Primal.
Ollie in Assassin's Creed?
You could. It would fit. But don't... Be creative, for the love of God. Be creative.
Yeah.
Don't go Batman or Nightwing.
Fuck.
Well, shit.
Like, if you play Need for Speed, don't go, I want to play The Flash Need for Speed, because it's just stupid. Just do something different.
Wally West.
I want to play Reverse Flash.
So you just want to, like,
make it as slow as possible. Yeah, that's the inverted Need for Speed.
Inverted Need for Speed. Need for
Wells,
slow.
Wells for speed.
Neglect for slow. So, no, be creative with it. The most creative answer will obviously get a prize from our coveted vault. Whoa.
And in terms of the question we got in last week, obviously one from the question queen, we will be rolling that one more week just because it was a fairly hefty question that requires about 80 different answers.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Yeah. Give us one more week just to compile the list properly on that one.
Mm,
but yeah, now, before we do leave, I want to check in the social media lounge because I understand... head into the social media lounge because I understand there was some social media activity.
Oh, Lord, what's happened
this
now?
Week?
Right. No, you got me something there. I don't fucking know what you're on about. On our website, which can be found at www.frombatcave.com.
Shameless plug.
Where you can find all of our videos, all of our episodes, all of our skits, all of our promos, and everything.
Mm-hmm. Now, to answer question one, have you seen Deadpool?
Yes, I have.
All right.
Maximum effort.
And what did you think?
Fucking loved it. I was sitting there just watching the movie, just fucking grinning ear to ear. Just, I loved the hilarity.
It was so good.
It was amazing.
It's a great film.
It is fucking fantastic.
I'm glad to hear you liked it.
Just the little things that they do, like even like when Francis escapes on the bridge with Colossus and he's doing a... just fucking hilarious. Yeah. Just, you know, stupid shit like that where he doesn't even say anything. but yeah, it's just...
Sorry, do you recommend a watch to the people at home?
Fucking watch.
I'm looking forward to the time we can review that film. That'll be coming soon. But in the meantime, that has brought us to the end of this week's episode. You're happy with everything this week? Any last parting words before we leave?
Get the fuck off my lawn.
Well, as always, I've been Red Thunder and Gerard, and they have been the Dad Knight Braden Ahern.
Ciao, Knives.
Oh. The probe Matt Richens.
Fucking brain dead from watching that movie.
And the Honey Badger Terrier Neil.
Chicken isn't vegan?
And we'll see you all next time here. If my fucking mouse starts working, which won't, ruining my own fucking outro because of these shitty ass cheap batteries. Gotta love fucking technical difficulties. Oh, the mouse has come back. We'll see you all next time.
Bye.
Fuck up free. I still don't understand this movie, man. Like, okay.
There's nothing to understand. Okay.
Like, it literally feels like the lucid dream of somebody who just ate all the LSD.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, that's the thing.
Like, the way I figure it, he probably ate at least 50 bucks worth of mushrooms. Probably
yeah.
100 bucks worth of dreams. So he probably...
Muskberries do taste like muskberries, yeah.
But the way I figured, he ate me about 150 bucks.
Yeah, well,
that's
the same
time.
That's
not...
visually stunning. That is what happened. Not like zero. Water like
that. Oh,
it's trash.
Water like that.
You can have a really nice...
steak, but it's not steak.
No, you can have a really nice stained glass red light window. Right? You can admire the work of it. You're not going to sit there and cover it for like an hour and a half going with it.
But the thing is, though,
what I have back in the day is you didn't have a
good meal. Yeah, the thing is, the stained glass window...
That was the most popular thing after. Maybe that's what this film was about, was Scott Pilgrim defeating the Christian plus being head by the beating the demon man. Hey, crack another fucking fight.
This has been a Cabana production. Thank you.